Yes, good morning, good afternoon, I see. Thank you very much for this opportunity to present a study, a risk assessment study of the incursion of exotic FMD viruses into Southeast Asia. And you will see some overlap with the discussion of you, Dr. Yuqi, already. Acknowledgements to the Australian Aid, OIE, CCFMD, and the study was conducted by Animal Health Works based in the Netherlands with technical support from Melissa McLaws, João Afonso, and Sachit Singh from Cambodia. And my name is Chris Bartos. Right, the reason is more or less already given by the presentation of Dong King with the exits of viruses from pool 2 with the possibility of incursion in this pool of Southeast Asia. The results of this study, just as a summary, is very much indicating that the risk of that incursion is very much not a matter of when, or sorry, not a matter of if, but very much a matter of when this will occur. And that was kind of underpinned by the incursion of Asia 1 at the time of this study. Also, what I will do in this presentation is make reference to the theme of this meeting and discuss with you demand and supply of vaccines to meet a challenging environment and a changing environment. So what we did, a risk assessment, so we were looking into what are the risks for introduction into Southeast Asia. We looked into release, we looked into exposure, and we looked into the consequence or the spread of these incursions. And we made use of a model published by Barbara Dufour that takes into account release and exposure assessment and combine that into a in a probability of occurrence and combine that with a consequence assessment. And those two combined, they come up with, or that allowed us to estimate the overall risk. How did we do it? By a qualitative assessment, we visited countries, a number of countries, not all. We collected the data from most of the countries in Southeast Asia. And we had an assessment workshop, or kind of a validation workshop, after we had done our data collection and country visits to discuss with the veterinary services from this region our preliminary results. We looked into 10 different risk pathways. So that was obvious ones like the live importation of livestock, legal and informal, the importation of animal byproducts, legal and informal. We looked into the risk pathways of wildlife, communal grazing, human movements, feed and fodder vehicles, and genetic materials. And we constructed, as an example given here, a risk pathway for each of these. And this is an example of a legal import of live animals and the release pathway. So here we had 5 steps and we qualified the risks by different levels between negligible, low, moderate, and high. And the combination of, in this example, of the release, shows a high and then 4 times moderate. So overall, this risk pathway was assessed as a moderate risk pathway. I cannot go into all other risk pathways, but you can find it in the report that was published. Summarizing the release through livestock and animal byproducts, I like to indicate more or less that there was importation of live animals, formal importation, from FMD endemic countries and even into countries that are free in Southeast Asia. Other issues I like to highlight is the informal importation of live animals. And that's already discussed that there is a huge demand by China, so that takes away cattle from Myanmar. And these are in some way give rise to an introduction of animals from Bangladesh and from India. Also, informal introduction of animal products is something that is happening on a large scale and also happening in from endemic countries into the different countries in Southeast Asia, free and non-free. Dr. Yu Qi already showed this photo. It's maybe not clear. I hope, yeah. This is China on this side, and this is Myanmar and Laos. And these are the numbers that are traded, estimates of numbers of live animals crossing the border from Laos, Myanmar into China. So there's a huge demand for cattle from Southeast Asia into China. This is based on a study from Polly Smith Cox. At the same time, there is trading of livestock from Vietnam to China, as well as pigs and poultry back from China into Vietnam. So there is, in this region, extensive trading. I also, from that same study, I copied this one, is to say, well, what are the price differentials between production or live animals in Myanmar, where the farmers can sell a live animal for $1 per kilo live weight, and the price paid in China, that is $3.60. So there is definitely a benefit for trading there. And that goes not directly always, that was the photo that I showed you, but also oftentimes go from Myanmar to Thailand, from Thailand to Laos, from Laos to China. So this takes a long route. Back to our study, the probability of occurrence, so the combination of release and exposure combined at this level here of the exposure and the result of the different pathways with regard to occurrence. Well, obviously there's a high probability of occurrence through live animals as well as animal products. We consider that low for wildlife and moderate for the three other risk pathways and negligible for communal grazing and genetic products. So that's on the first half. The second half of this study was about the consequence. And the consequence we defined, well, what can happen if it is released, exposed in Southeast Asia? Well, it can be limited to a farm level, or from the farm level it spreads into the country, or from a country it spreads even further into the region. What are key factors here? Well, key factors, especially at the national level and the regional level, is the time for detection, is the time to respond, or the capacity to respond. And key is also, well, what is the trading within that region? Consequences are obviously is not only animal health and welfare, but also that the cost for control, and at the regional level, or at the national level, also the trade opportunity losses, or losses to trade. So that's what we assessed. For this, we looked into the capacity of veterinary services based on PVS evaluation and gap analysis. And I like to highlight for this part, those three main or four mainland countries, Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Vietnam, where basically you see the combination of the quality of veterinary service assessed as being poor. They have extensive connection or trading within that region, and so the risk of spreading is high for these for this consequence. So overall consequence assessment is basically if it happens with the information that we assessed, then for all of these pathways there's a high consequence. And really I think what we are, or at least if I speak for myself, what was a clear outcome is that the importation of animal and animal byproducts is happening on a large scale and is happening to a large extent in informal way. So not only live animals but also animal products are a real danger. So that bringing back together to this overview, where release and exposure ranged between low to high, consequence in all situations for all risk pathways had a high probability. So that's where we ended up with our risk estimation to be overall high, And therefore we said it's not so much a matter of if it is going to happen, it's rather an issue of when it's going to happen. Third part is on, what is the situation in South East Asia in reference, or how does this study support or is related to this conference? Well, I have an overview from our report on the vaccine use, and I combined it with the data from FAO stats on the number of animals in the different countries of mainland Southeast Asia. And you see that, well, for Laos, Myanmar, Cambodia, its vaccination numbers, or the doses used, are very much, are relatively small related to the animal population. Whereas Malaysia, Thailand, and Vietnam, they already have a larger scale vaccination programs. But also what this points out is that for these three countries, vaccination is very much a project-based vaccination campaign, as Dr. Yuchi was also explaining, and not so much integrated as part of veterinary or disease control programs. The recommendations we had in our report were in different categories, and I have taken out four here: overarching regional, overarching, so overarching all the risk pathways, regional as well as national, and livestock related, regional and national. And of course, there are some obvious recommendations there, but the ones with dashed lines around it, around the text box, are the ones that I like to further elaborate upon, and that is my last slide. Before that, though, I like to stress, well, of course, there's a need for progressive control of FMD in these countries, and I think you are in a good position. Oh, wait a minute, sorry. Because on Wednesday morning, we will discuss in more detail how progressive control of FMD can also be combined, can be broadened to include progressive control of other diseases. That's a discussion with Dr. Melissa McClaws, as well as how can progressive control of FMD be better embedded in a policy, of a government policy, I should say, and relate to the interest of stakeholders, private stakeholders. And that's another discussion on Wednesday morning. Just final slide, what did we recommend? Well, the need for a vaccine bank, emergency vaccine bank, that's on the agenda in the region. Again, this was already kind of elaborated or referred to in the opening session, opening part. And we also discussed, or there may be an interest for the use of the pragmatist tool for this region. However, that may then need some modification of the tool itself disintegrating it by country and maybe including some more information about vaccine coverage to allow for risk mapping. Legalize the livestock trade between countries and China. Yeah, it's not so much for the incursion of exotic viruses maybe, but definitely the demand of livestock by China is organizing a lot of trading in mainland Southeast Asia with the risk of importation from India and Bangladesh. Already referred to are the ongoing negotiations between China and Myanmar and China and Laos, with some requirements by the Chinese on FMD free status. So that's an interesting approach and not easy to establish. Related to private sector initiatives to increase vaccination coverage, I think key really is to go from project-based vaccination to market-driven control of FMD. Allow private sector to apply FMD vaccination, and that is, I can add to what Dr. Yuchi was referring to in the Myanmar situation, that in Myanmar they have now established a cattle trade board, which is really bringing together private and public sector to discuss, well, how are we going about these supply, the demand by China with regard to the conditions set. And then the role, I think, of the veterinary service is to really move maybe from delivering vaccine is to make sure that they have a supervisory role in making sure that the vaccines that are allowed, that are registered, are of good quality and are well monitored. I think that's a changing position. I also made an additional column for community animal health workers. Dr. Juan Lubroth mentioned or referred to the use of a lot of antibiotics for treating FMD. I think this is where the people on the ground are very important, to train them well, to explain what they can do about FMD. And so that's where, again, in Myanmar, they are now working on accreditation of community animal health workers to take them up officially or to be acknowledged into the veterinary services or as part of the veterinary services. Of course, these people in the field are also the ones that can help not only on the global demand for vaccine, but also to deliver the vaccine. I think that's a key issue, of course, how to get it into the animal. And again, if they are well trained and accredited, yeah, that may help to provide good vaccination. Last point, of course, they are part of early detection. They are part of the surveillance. With that, I'd like to thank you, and I can refer to the ISBN number there. So if you are interested, you can find this report on the internet, on the OIE site. Thank you very much.